And for July, it will be tuna and chicken, tuna or chicken in the can. This is the canned kind. So keep that in mind for July. Also, Cheryl and I are going to be taking off right after the service. This is our grandson's last baseball game for the year, and he requested that we would be present. So what else is a grandparent supposed to do? At any rate, so we're going to miss Marshall's. But I assume that we'll have a bit of contingency, and maybe I can get a substitute to take our place. Are there any other announcements this morning? If there are no other announcements, then let us stand and worship God and begin with our call to worship. God beyond us, God within us, you call us to wholeness and passion for life.
We give you thanks and for promised life.
You assure us that you are with us.
We give you thanks for promised life.
By your mercy and your love for the world, you comfort us and hold us.
We give you thanks for promised life.
Come, let us worship God in truth and in spirit. Our opening hymn 103, Immortal, Invisible God Only Walks. Let us pray. Sometimes, God, we have questions. Sometimes we are ashamed of our questions, or we think only we have the right questions and the right answers. Sometimes we think we have life all figured out. We don't need you. It is then that we feel abandoned. Forgive us, Creator of all things living. Heal us. Help us. We are weak. Make us strong. Glory to you, Lord. Amen. God so loved the world that God did not send a dictator. God did not send a government. God sent Jesus our Christ, God's living presence and living love, not to condemn the world, but to embrace the world in loving grace. Sisters and brothers in Christ, we are loved and we are forgiven. May the Lord add a blessing to that. Let us respond with the Spirit of the living God, and on page 7 of the hymnal, the Apostles' Creed. At any rate, read a story about Naboth's vineyard. And I want us to feel this not as history, but as a history lesson, because there's a huge difference. And that'll be clearer as we go through this, and as we get to the end, you'll see, I hope, you'll see, and I remember to bring it back to that as I finish. It is a history lesson. This is 1 Kings, 21st chapter, beginning at the first verse. Later, the following events took place. Naboth, the Jezreelite, had a vineyard in Jezreel, beside the palace of King Ahab of Samaria. And Ahab said to Naboth, "Give me your vineyard, so that I may have it for a vegetable garden, because it is near my house," which is actually the palace. "I will give you a better vineyard for it, or if it seems good to you, I will give you its value in money." But Naboth said to Ahab, "The Lord forbid that I should give you my ancestral inheritance." Ahab went home resentful and sullen because of what Naboth the Jezreelite had said to him. Now, isn't this poor Ahab? Here he is, king of Israel, and he wants a vegetable garden. Now, we have Naboth over here, just a normal person of the land, and he has this perfect land for a vegetable garden. And Naboth is thinking, "I'm king. I should get whatever I want." Now, keep in mind that Ahab has been a little bit of a scoundrel. When he first took over being king of Israel, he was maybe okay. But after he took his wife Jezebel, the princess, the Phoenician princess, everything went downhill from that point. She brought in the god of Baal and the god of Asherah, and began seeking it with the god of Israel. And the next thing you know, we had more of the foreign gods and idols, and we didn't have much of the one Lord God of Israel in the worship at all. And so things were going south quickly. And now Ahab said, "I want this land." And Naboth says, "Listen, this is my ancestral inheritance. This is the land for my children, my children's children, my children's children's children, on and on and on. It's the only thing I have that defines who I am. You have this great kingdom. You are the king. You can get anything you want. You can go anywhere you want, and you can just go get more land somewhere else. I can't. This is my land. It's the only thing I have." Well, what Ahab does, and not only did he get sullen and resentful, he goes, "I will not give you my ancestral heritage." He lay down on his bed, turned away his face, and he would not eat. Well, here is poor King Ahab. Him is at home and lying in bed, and, "Oh, Jezebel, I don't feel like eating. Naboth said I couldn't have my vegetable garden, and I can't believe that that's happening to me. I am the king. I should have whatever in the world that I want." His wife Jezebel came to him and said, "Why are you so depressed that you will not eat?" And he said, "Because I spoke to Naboth, the Jezreelite, and said to him, 'Give me your vineyard for money, or else, if you prefer, I'll give you another vineyard for it.' But he answered, 'I will not give you my vineyard.' Now his wife Jezebel said to him, 'Do you now govern Israel? Do you now govern Israel?'" Well, of course he does. He's the king. She knew it. He knew it. And what she meant, "Why don't we just go and take it? We are bigger than he is. We have more power than he has. It doesn't matter whether he owns it or he doesn't own it. We can just take it. Nobody can stop us." So she wrote letters in Ahab's name and sealed them with his seal. She sent the letters to the elders and the nobles who lived with Naboth in his city. Now, she sends these letters, and she sends them to the nobles and the elders, the people of power, the people that King Ahab owned, the people who were afraid to say anything against King Ahab. And we'll see why they were afraid to say anything against Ahab as we continue to read the letter. She wrote in the letters, "Proclaim a fast," this is a religious gathering, "and seek Naboth at the head of the assembly. Set two scoundrels opposite of him." Now, two scoundrels. She knew there would be no trouble finding him because these were what? The town's enforcers. These are the ones that knew they could do anything illegal as long as the nobles and the politicians and the king said to go do it. They didn't want to get dirt on their hands, so they said, the scoundrels. Seek two scoundrels opposite him and have them bring a charge against him, saying, "You have cursed God and the king. Then take him out and stone him to death." The men of the city, the elders and the nobles who lived in the city, did as Jezebel had sent word to them, just as it was written in the letters, and she had sent to them. They proclaimed a fast and seated Naboth at the head of the assembly. The two scoundrels came and sat opposite him. And the scoundrels brought a charge against Naboth in the presence of the people, saying, "Naboth cursed God and the king." So they took him up side of the city and stoned him to death. Now, this was the punishment for blasphemy against God and against the king. And they had a place of execution outside the city. You would go outside the city, and then you could be up on a little bluff, a little side of a cliff. You throw the person off, they would fall down onto these big rocks below, and then they would take boulders and then they would throw them down on top of them until they were dead. So now Naboth is dead. Then they sent to Jezebel saying, "Naboth has been stoned and he is dead." As soon as Jezebel heard that Naboth had been stoned and was dead, Jezebel said to Ahab, "Go take possession of the vineyard of Naboth, this Jezreelite, which he refused to give you for money, for Naboth is not alive, but is dead." As soon as Ahab heard that Naboth was dead, Ahab set out to go down to the vineyard and of Naboth the Jezreelite and take possession. Now, King Ahab's happy. He got exactly what he wanted. Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, "Go down to meet King Ahab of Israel, who rules in Samaria. He is now in the vineyard of Naboth, where he has gone to take possession. You shall say to him, 'Thus says the Lord, have you killed and also taken possession?' You shall say to him, 'Thus says the Lord, in the place where dogs licked up the blood of Naboth, dogs will also lick up your blood.' Ahab said to Elijah, 'Have you found me, O my enemy?' He answered, 'I have found you, because you have sold yourself to do what is evil.'" So now we have a prophecy that Ahab's foul deeds are going to follow him. And I said from before, this is not just history. This is not just an event that took place somewhere around, I don't know, 825, 830 BC. It is a history lesson. And a lesson is more than just the chronological order of dates. And we all know that when we say that if we ignore history, we will repeat it again. And it could be a good thing or it could be a bad thing that we are repeating. In this case, if we were following Ahab, it would be a very bad thing indeed. But as we get just a little bit further into this, we'll see that in the end, something changes. Something takes place. Something brings this back to some kind of sanity. Because this is insane. This is a kingdom going amok. And so what we do know has happened after this is that Ahab's brother, one of his brothers, took over as king, which didn't please Jezebel because she was happy being queen in the meantime. But he had an accident and died. I don't know what the accident was, but his other brother took over. Sounds a little suspicious to me. Well, his other brother, as he was taken over, the captain of the military, the commander of the military, killed him. Jehu came in and killed him. And so Jehu decides the only thing that's standing between me as the commander of the army and the kingship is Jezebel. So he gets his chariot, he gets out of the army, he goes tramping in. Jezebel knows he's coming. So what does she do? She puts on all the fancy clothes that she can. She puts on a formal wig and she paints herself all up. She gets out to the window and she looks out and she hears the horses coming. Clop, 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 here they come. She sees Jehu. She knows what's going to happen. She knows what's going to happen. She's going to die. She didn't go out there to tempt Jehu. She didn't go out there to seduce him. She went out there to say, I am stately, I am eloquent, I am the queen. If you take me down, you have taken down the queen of Israel, and the people will see me as the queen who was killed. So Jehu looks up and he yells into the servants, throw her out the window. Now, I don't know how high up in the palace she was, but it was just like they took her like a barco lounger and threw her right out the window. Imagine that. And she crashed onto the rocks below. The Bible says that her blood splattered up against the house. Then, to add insult to injury, Jehu's chariot and his horses trampled her. So, what's Jehu do? He goes, well, it's time for lunch. Yeah, that's one job done. Let's go have lunch. So he goes into the palace because he's taken over now. And he sits in there and he's thinking about this. Because you know, she was queen. She actually deserves a little better respect than that. I tell you what, guys, go out, get her, at least bury her. We'll make that, you know, we'll show a little bit of compassion here. So the servants go out, and what do they find? All they can find is a skull, two hands, and two feet. Because the feral dogs of the town came in and ate and carried away all the remains except for the skull, the two hands, and the two feet. And that was the end of Jezebel. This is not just history, it is a history lesson. And so if we go back and look at this as a lesson, we need to take something out of this that we can carry away from here, besides this horrible, horrible story about this death and destruction. It sounds to me like the world just burned up and was destroyed, and certainly in this kingdom it looked that way. But again, there is a lesson here. When King Ahab had taken in Jezebel, something occurred that turned the tide of what the future was going to be. And when she came in and they started mixing who they were worshiping, a big change came upon the hearts of the people. And what happened was, it was almost like, well, we just choose who we worship. We just choose who we serve. We just choose whichever direction we want to go, and it's going to be okay. And the lesson there is, I think, one that we are continuing to see all around us. Because what I see is that people are beginning to make God a preference. And I'm not the only one. I don't know if you remember, but he just passed away, Charles Krauthammer. Well, in about 2003, I think it was, he wrote an article in Time magazine entitled, "Will It Be Coffee, Tea, or He?" Coffee, tea, or he? And what he was writing was, he explores the demise of the importance of faith and religion in society of the decade of the 90s. He notes that religion and faith has become to be more of a preference than a way of life. You know, a preference, like coffee, tea, or he, and the he being God. And whenever that happens, things begin to erode. Church services become entertainment. People play ukuleles. They throw barber loungers out the window. But if they're really careful, they also preach the gospel. Amen. And they let us know the lessons of the past so we don't repeat the things that have brought down and caused destruction and caused people to be carried away to something else. When it's a preference, it's like I get up in the morning and I think, I can have cornflakes or Rice Krispies. That's a preference, and there's probably going to be no damage if I do that. Or I can say I can put on gray socks or black socks. That's a preference. So it doesn't really, it's not going to change my life 5, 10, or 15 years from now. But if I say I'm going to go out today into this world and, you know what, God, I think it would be my preference if you didn't go with me today. I think you should stay here, relax, get into my chair, kick it back, watch a little bit of Netflix. It'll be good for you, and I'll get away from you for a little while. We all need me time. And so we leave without God. That means I can go to work, and if something is unethical, just nobody going to whisper anything in my ear because it's me. And I decide that's okay. There's a prophet there, so I'll do that. Or if we're walking around and someone is trying to bake some food, we decide that person needs to go get a job. If that person got a job, they wouldn't be begging food. So I don't have to give them any food. That person is not my responsibility. If a neighbor comes up and says, you know what, George, I tell you what, we're going to go out and we're going to fix up some things in the church this weekend. Ooh, I can't do that, I'll be out of town. But I know I'm not going to be out of town. Because there's no voice in me saying anything. That is my preference. And it's not long we see that God stays at home more, more, and more each day. And then, at the end, we have involved all kinds of people around us that become complicit with us and support us because we're doing great things. We're getting well respected. We're making a lot of money. We're going out and having a lot of fun. We're telling jokes and we're going on and people are running around us and they think we're great people. It's just like the folks of Naboth's time. You know, the king, Jezebel's complicit, the elders and the leaders of the village are complicit, the two scoundrels are complicit, all the people who threw the stones are complicit, and the whole world is crashing and burning. Now, that's depressing. But I want us to take something more positive away from the lesson, because I want to tell you, this just may be the most positive message that we can find in the entire Bible. And I mean this. The positive thing is, even though the world around Naboth crashed and burned, there was to rebuild. And the remnant began to look at the Word of God. And the remnant began to worship God. And the remnant began to walk with God. And the world began to get better. And better and better. Because they took on, let us love the Lord our God with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind, and all of our strength, and let us love our neighbor as ourselves. And it began to rebuild. Now, we can't rebuild the whole world. If we think this world is crashing and burning, okay, maybe it isn't, I don't know. I really have no idea. I don't care. It's not my responsibility whether the whole world is going to crash and burn. My world doesn't have to crash and burn. Shirley's world doesn't have to crash and burn. And your world doesn't have to crash and burn. Because the only thing we do is take what out of this lesson and do it. It's so simple. It's so simple. What do we do? Oh, I remember. I want to love the Lord my God with all my heart, all my soul, all my mind, all my strength. And I'm going to love my neighbor as myself. And my world comes back together. It can be ablaze all around me. But all of a sudden, I'm feeling the joy. All of a sudden, I'm celebrating with this congregation. I'm celebrating with other people who are rebuilding the world in God's image. We don't have to change the world. We just have to change us. And we become the remnant. I think that's pretty powerful. Amen. What do we do now? Well, now it's time to continue our celebration with receiving our offering. Just the ones having that horrible Naboth being stoned to death. I don't know what she was thinking by the time she got done listening to Jezebel and the dogs and the it's hard to say, but it's going to go around town today. Let us pray. Almighty God, we come to you this day and we lift our spirits as we bow our heads. We only bow, Lord, because we are in your presence. We feel a humility to be with you. We feel a gratitude because you have given us grace. Even all these slips and falls and the things of the past and the battles and the wars and all that, Lord, through it all, we have grace. We just give you the thanks for that, Lord. We just pray for this church. Let us come together and share your love in a very special manner. And not only here within the bounds of these walls, but certainly out in the street, well beyond the street. We pray for all those today who are suffering and trying to find a home, and that none seems to be around. People who are running in fear because to stay where they are could possibly mean death, not only for them, but their entire families. We pray for the people who are trying to take care of all these situations as well, Lord. We all have different ideas of how things should be handled, I'm sure. But Lord, what really needs to be done is your will. Please guide everybody to put away the rhetoric, to put away the hostilities, to actually come together and decide, you know what, Lord, we got to do what the right thing is, and let us do it together. Let us give these people some hope. Let us be your people. We pray for our country as a whole. There's a whole lot that needs to be done, Lord, and there's a whole lot that's causing a lot of dissension. But you are the God of peace. And so we are praying for peace. Enter into our spirits and guide us that we might be the remnant that you desire us to be. And all that we can't put into words, Lord, we ask you hear us as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is 398.